Welcome back, boys and girls, to the third week of our missionary story called A Little Rascal Who Became a Man of God. And we're going to quickly review and go over what we've talked about so far. But first, I have to announce the winner. So we had about the same amount come in of answers from you children. And we did another random drawing, and the winner of this week's gift card is Isaiah Ryder. So congratulations, Isaiah. Pastor Mike will be mailing you your gift card. Make sure you send those in. We got some entries. Maybe there's several children in your family, and we got an entry from one child, but not the others. So make sure you're sending these in. It's an easy, fun way to be in the drawing to win a gift card. So make sure you do that by next Sunday. Answer this week's questions, and you'll be entered into our drawing. So let's quickly go over what we've been talking about. So remember, the Rossi family were in a great big earthquake or terremoto, and they lost their home and they lost their brother. And we won't go over everything we've talked about, but we've learned that Tony is definitely a little rascal, and he gets himself in situations where he gets himself into trouble, or attention is drawn to him when he chases cars and does little things like that. And every time I go over this, I often think of some of you in my children's church, because some of you can be a little rascally. I know Miss Jessica has had rascally moments. I called my mom when I was preparing for this week's lesson, and I called her and I said, "Mom, can you remember a time when I was young where I did something that you would call rascally?" And she said, "Oh, when you were little," talking about me. So when I was little, she said that after she would send me to bed, she would sit up and she would watch TV. And where her chair was, it was right by our hallway, and our bedrooms were down the hallway. And she said that every night I would sneak out of my bed and I would crawl down the hallway as quiet as I could. And I would crawl underneath her chair, and I would lay under her chair on the ground like this, and I would watch TV. And she said, "I did it every night." And every night she'd catch me, she'd whoop me, and she'd send me back to bed. So I even have had rascally moments, as I'm sure all of you have. So one important thing we have talked about Anthony is Anthony has questions about God. Remember when he went to his church, he was told in order to go to heaven, you had to say your prayers every day, morning and night, for 7 years, and don't miss one time. And Tony was a little bit concerned about that. And then we learned last week that something very sad in his life happened. Remember, Tony's mom passed away. She had a little daughter, and then later she got cancer and she passed away. Anthony got a job, because remember, he dreamed of going to America. He got a job driving a shuttle bus, and ended up, it was the time of World War II. It was World War II, and he went to fight the battle. And remember last week, he ended up stepping on a rusty nail and he almost died, but God spared his life. And when he got out of the army or the military, he decided there's no point in going home. My mom's dead. My other family members have passed. My brothers and sisters have gone away. I am going to go to America. But then he had another setback. Every ship he tried to go on, they told him, "Oh, they're full. They're full. You can't come." So we're going to pick up there today, and we're going to talk about that. What happens now in his life? So you guys listen, because remember, we're going to have some questions at the end. You can submit them to be in the drawing. Okay, so make sure you listen. So 10 days after Tony contacted one of the ships, he received a message that somebody who was supposed to be on the ship all the way to America was sick. And so they were not going to be able to go. And there was one spot open. Tony said, "I will go." He was so excited. So Tony got his passport. He borrowed some money from his family. He told them goodbye. He packed his bag and he got on the ship to America. He was so excited. He raced up the gangplank, got on the huge ship with his suitcase. He had 30 American dollars in his pocket, which wasn't much. And he set off all the way to America. So he was going to ride from Italy all the way to New York. And finally, when he got to New York, what do you think the first thing he saw was? I'll give you a clue. If you sail into New York today, this still will be the first thing you see. He saw the Statue of Liberty. He could not believe that he was finally seeing the Statue of Liberty. "There she is," he cried. The Statue of Liberty. He was finally in America. I gotta turn this page here. Give me one second. All right. So he was finally in America and he was so excited. He saw ships all over the harbor and he saw men in business suits scurrying to and fro doing their business and ready to go do the amazing things that America had to offer. Well, Tony was only 21 years old and Tony started to realize, "Oh, man, now I'm in America and that's great, but I don't speak English." Tony only knew four things in English. He knew how to say please, yes, no, and I am hungry. That's all he knew how to say. He didn't have a place to stay. He didn't have anything. He only had a little bit of money in his pocket. Well, his uncle lived in America. He lined up an Italian family that lived in America to help Tony. So Tony, his uncle gave Tony the address to where he needed to go. Tony just had to get there. So he found the train station and he realized he really needed help. He didn't know where he was going. And all he could muster out the words was, "Please, please Bleecker Street." He asked one of the conductors on the train, "Please, Bleecker Street." And the conductor said, "Okay, I'll tell you when to get off." So Tony said, "Okay." So he got on the train and they started going stop after stop after stop. Tony realized he had been on the train a long time. And he couldn't talk to anyone because they didn't speak the same language. And he started to kind of feel lonely. And questions started going through his mind. "When will I get off on Bleecker Street? And after Bleecker Street, how will I find Thompson Street? Will my uncle's friends be nice to me? How long will it take me to find a job? My $30 won't last me long." So all these things were going through Tony's head. So finally, Tony realized he had been on the train a long time. And he looked at the conductor again and he said again, "Please, Bleecker Street." And the conductor was very impatient with him. And he waved at Tony, indicating that Tony had already missed his stop. So he said, get off here, get on the next train and go back two stops. Oh, Tony got off the train. He was nervous, didn't know what to do. When he got off the train, there was an Italian boy shining people's shoes. And he realized that the Italian boy spoke the same language he did. So he asked him, he said, "Oh, can you please help me find Bleecker Street?" It was so nice to hear someone speak his language. And the Italian boy told him exactly where to go. And when he got off his next stop, there was a sign right in front of him that told him the next street he needed. And he was able to find where he needed to go. Well, when Tony got there, he was greeted with the most warm welcome. They hugged him. They all spoke his language, and it was so nice. And they told him, they said, "Your uncle has lined up a job for you at your uncle's machine shop. So you are going to go there this afternoon and you're going to go for your job interview. Tony was so excited. He just got to America and already he was going for a job interview. They told him, they said, you're going to hand us the tools we need. You're going to help us do different projects and you're going to learn the trade. And he was so excited. They said, be here at 7 o'clock tomorrow morning. Wow, Tony already had a job. Now he realized, oh, I need a place to stay. But do you know the friends he had just made had already arranged that for him? They said there is an Italian family on West Broadway and it's an apartment on the 6th floor and they have a room for you. So now, here's this 21-year-old boy, and after being in America only a few hours, he already had a job, he had a place to stay, and he already had friends. Well, one thing Anthony wasn't prepared for, boys and girls, was the winters in New York. He was so cold, even laying in his warm bed under blankets and blankets. He was so cold. He would get up for work and his feet would hit that cold, cold floor and he would just freeze with a chill. And as he would get ready for work, he one day was thinking, man, I sure wish that when I got home from work today, there could be a nice warm pot of soup waiting for me. Well, that couldn't happen because he was at work. And when he got home, if he wanted soup, he would then have to cook this soup. So, you remember back when Tony and his brother were trying to catch the two mice? Do you remember how innovative he was and how he rigged the little trap to catch the mice? Well, that's something Tony was kind of good at. And in his little rascally brain, he thought, you know what? My alarm clock that woke me up this morning, I wonder if I could use that to rig up to my stove so that my stove could turn on at just the right time and cook me soup. So you know what? That's what he did. He took his alarm clock and he took his alarm clock apart and he got some string and he tied the legs of his alarm clock to the left burner on his stove. Then he tied a cord to a wind-up key on his clock, taking the other end of the cord and fastening it to the stove handle. So when that wound around, it would turn the stove on. He also took a pot and he put in it the water and all the ingredients he needed for his soup. And he said, there, now when I get home from work, this soup will be ready for me to eat. He was always coming up with different things. So Tony went to work, he came home and he had his nice warm soup waiting for him. So his next challenge, as you would imagine living in New York, was to drive a taxi cab. So after 6 months, he bought his very own car and he started driving a taxi cab. He left the machine shop. He was now a taxi cab driver through New York City. And then he thought, I bet that being a chauffeur, you could make more money than driving a taxi cab. And boys and girls, I don't know if you know what a chauffeur is, but a chauffeur is like a personal driver. So people who need to go places, they have chauffeurs. So the chauffeur makes sure that they have a car ready to drive this person wherever they need to go at a certain time, and then they take them home. And he thought, there's got to be more money in being a chauffeur. So Tony, he heard of a man named Mr. Root who had some money, and he knocked on his door one day. And this wealthy owner, he was kind of a stuffy man and proud, and he was the kind of man who wore gloves when he read newspapers because he didn't want to get his hands dirty. And he knocked on his door, and he said, I would like to be your chauffeur. So he had his meeting with Mr. Root. And Mr. Root said, how much do you charge a month for your car and your services? And without even blinking an eye, Tony said, $450 a month. Whoa, that sounds kind of steep, don't you think? Said Mr. Root. And boys and girls, just 1 year ago, when Tony came to America, he was making $140 a month at the workshop. Now here he is. He's a taxi driver, now a chauffeur, and he's making $450 a month. And so Mr. Root said, I don't know, that seems kind of steep. He said, why don't you go home and think about your price and let me know if you want to come down on that price. And Tony left, and the man knew that Tony wasn't going to come down on his price. So by the time Tony got back to his apartment and walked in, the phone was ringing, and it was Mr. Root. He said, I'll take you up on your offer. He said, be at my home at 1:15 sharp. And so Tony became his driver. And Mr. Root didn't speak to him very much. He didn't like to talk to people. But one thing he would do is he had a bell. And he would ring the bell one time for Tony to stop the car. He would ring it two times if he wanted Tony to turn right. And he would ring it three times if he wanted Tony to turn left. And with no one to talk to, and he did a lot of driving with no one to talk to, what do you think was going on? What do you think Tony would spend his time doing while he drove all the time? He would think. And he decided, you know what? I need to start doing something else. I'm working for him full time, but I need to start doing something part time. So you know what he started doing? He started going into the country, and he would get chicken eggs, and he'd bring them into the city, and he would sell the chicken eggs. And people loved them. And eventually, Tony's brother Joe also came to America, and they opened a grocery store together. They called it Aurora Farms, and they advertised Aurora Farms. Eggs only after 1 day old. And their little store did really well. Tony was good at running the store. He could remember prices. He was really good with the customers, and he could always find a really good deal. And even though at that point, guys, this was like the 1920s, the Depression was going on. So a lot of people didn't have money, and a lot of stores were closing. But not this store. This store kept doing well. So one day, a man came into Tony's store, him and Joe's store, and said, I want to buy your store with everything in it for $30,000. Tony thought, well, I've really enjoyed working Aurora Farms store, but I've always wanted to try my hand at a restaurant. So he sold his store, and he started a restaurant. Well, after only a year, Tony noticed that the store he had sold, Aurora Farms, the one he sold to this gentleman, had closed up. And he asked around, what happened? Why did this store close? And people said, you know, it just came into hard times, and the guy just gave up and he shut the store down. Well, Tony started thinking of happy days at Aurora Farms and how he liked it. And you know what he did? He turned to his brother, Joe, and he said, Joe, I'm going to leave you my restaurant. His restaurant was doing great. He said, you can have the restaurant. I'm going to go back and work Aurora Farms. So he did. And as soon as Tony got in there and he started working the store again, guess what? Started to do really well. People in the neighborhood were so happy to see Tony back, and the store started selling a lot, and people were so happy. And God really blessed the store again. Well, as Tony ran the store, somebody in the store, a young lady, caught his eye. And he started to watch her shop, and he started to wonder what she was like. And he said, I've never met anyone like her before, he thought. He said, and in his rascally mind, Tony started working up a plan on how he could get to know this young lady who shopped in his store. Well, that is where we end off for this week. So next week, we'll find out how, if Tony gets to meet this lady, and how what other rascally ideas he comes up with on how to meet her and get to know her. And so make sure that you, I hope you paid attention, and make sure that you download the questions and send the email to Pastor Mike before next Saturday. And next Sunday when you watch the story, you will get to hear who won this week's gift card. So you guys take care, and I'll see you next time.